Thanks, Mary Frances. Today I'm going to talk to you about the importance of the land use change and forestry sector for Ireland, which is usually discussed using the acronym LULUCF. This LULUCF sector in of itself is not something that is discussed largely in terms of greenhouse gas emissions, but is going to become quite important in terms of our compliance with the LULUCE regulation going forward. In terms of my presentation today, I'm going to cover a number of points. Firstly, what is LULUCF and its importance, trends in land use over time, emissions and removals from the LULUCF sector, a number of broad points in terms of the LULUCF regulation of 2018, what has been done in terms of national research and what needs to be done to capture all the relevant information associated with land, and some general conclusions. So what is LULUCF? Well, LULUCF stands for Land Use Change and Forestry. And it includes both the greenhouse gas emissions and removals associated with activities on land. It's not a new sector. LULUCF has been reported as part of national emission inventories, along with more familiar sectors such as agriculture and energy, to both the EU Commission and the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, in line with reporting guidelines. However, when we discuss national emissions to date, LULUCF is not included in the national totals and is not used towards compliance to 2020 under the effort sharing decision. More importantly, another point to make is that the LULUCF sector or land-based activities are reported separately to those in agriculture, and this is in line with international reporting guidelines set out by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. In terms of what's included in the LULUCF sector, it includes the following land uses: forestland, cropland, grassland, wetlands, settlements and other land. Not only does it include these individual land uses, but also conversions between these individual land uses. So for example, afforestation on grasslands is a conversion from grasslands to forestry, or indeed deforestation of forestland being the conversion of forestland to grassland, for example. Within each of these individual land uses, five carbon pools are assessed. These are above ground biomass, below ground biomass, dead organic matter, which includes both litter and deadwood, and soils. Additionally, emissions of nitrous oxide and methane, which are not already reported in the agricultural sector, are included. And what I mean here is the drainage and rewetting of soils, for example, and indeed the emissions of greenhouse gases associated with wildfires and controlled burning on land. As a general rule of thumb, land cover does not equal land use. Land cover is a term that is used quite broadly, and it describes the physical material on the surface of the earth. When we talk about land use, what we're talking about is the management or the use of this physical material on the surface of the earth. And a couple of examples here is that in terms of land cover, we're talking about, for example, grass, trees or bare ground. However, in terms of the management of those physical materials, what is the grass used for? Is it for pasture? In terms of our forest, are those trees managed in a particular way? There's other issues also to note in terms of the requirements under LULUCF reporting, and two of the most important ones that I'd like to present here is, one is in relation to the forest definition. The definition of a forest is very particular within LULUCF regulations, and it includes a minimum area of 0.1 hectares, minimum width of 20 metres, and trees have to be higher than 5 metres. In terms of other issues to note is the definitions between peatlands and organic soils. Peatland is a land cover, so there could be multiple land uses. So for example, if grass use for grazing is present on a peatland, well, that is actually reported as a grassland on an organic side under the LULUCF reporting mechanisms. Why LULUCF? As I briefly mentioned at the start, land use change in forestry has not been included in EU targets to date in terms of its use towards meeting long-term climate goals. However, the effort sharing regulation does provide, as Stephen pointed out earlier on, 26.8 million tonnes of CO2 equivalent of land-based credits for Ireland under that particular piece of legislation. Sister legislation, which is the LULUCF regulation, clearly sets out that the LULUCF sector has the potential to provide long-term climate benefits. It addresses the multiple objectives of the agricultural and land use sectors, with their lower mitigation potential. It also drives home the point that the sustainable land management practices will contribute to both climate change and GHG emission mitigation in several ways, in particular by reducing emissions and maintaining and enhancing six and carbon stocks. Furthermore, it is clearly outlined in the Climate Action Plan that land use is to be part of future development of environmental sustainability, and that Ireland's contribution to climate targets, including the delivery of the flexibility of 26.8 million tonnes, should be met. In this slide, I'm just going to give a brief overview of the trends in land use over time, because there's a number of important points that need to be shown from it. On the left, we have the proportion of the land use in 1990 across the relevant land uses. And on the right hand side, the proportion of those land uses in 2018. And the first point to note is the increase in our forest area from approximately 6.8% in 1990 to 11% in 2018. Furthermore, you will note a reduction in the grassland area, and this is mainly due to afforestation of grasslands. In terms of our cropland cohort, this has remained relatively stable. And you will also note that we assess managed and unmanaged wetlands, and that these areas have remained relatively stable over the time period as well. Finally, there has been a small increase in the proportion of settlements. And when we talk about settlements under LULUCF reporting, this is a sealed surface in the landscape, so roads, buildings, houses, etc. The graphic presented here on this slide is courtesy of the IPCC and the European Environment Agency. It provides a kind of clear linkage of what we mean in terms of LULUCF. On the right hand side, in the red box, which covers methane emissions from animals, nitrogen from fertilizer applications, methane emissions from manure management. These are all human-induced activities. Whereas those in the blue box are linked to the global natural carbon cycle, but are partially linked or induced by human activities. And as you will note here, the linkages between CO2 emissions from litter and deadwood, but also, as I mentioned earlier, methane and nitrous oxide emissions from biomass, and sinks of soil carbon in the soil and through harvest of wood products. So when we talk about emissions and removal from the LULUCF sector, there's a couple of important points that need to be got across. Firstly, land in an individual year is a net source of emissions. However, hidden within that, forest land is a net sink. Grasslands and wetlands are a significant source of emissions from land in an Irish context, and this is largely as a result of the drainage of peatlands and the drainage of organic soils and grasslands. However, when assessing land-based activities in terms of the accounting principles or in terms of the LULUCF regulations, the comparison that is made in terms of grasslands and wetlands and croplands is against the baseline. And this term is called net accounting. So as you can see here, for 1990, we've approximately 7.2 million tons of CO2 equivalent in 1990. However, in 2018, approximately 7 million tons. The accounted for value is the difference between these two. Going forward under the effort sharing regulation, the same principle applies. However, the base period is the average of emissions and removals in 2005 to 2009. There's also a specific definition surrounding forestry, termed gross net accounting, in terms of, and this relates to our afforestation. And this is the actual sink value in a particular year. However, in relation to forest management activities, these are compared against a forest management reference level, and under the LULUCF regulation, a national forest accounting plan has been put in place to develop these estimates. As I mentioned earlier, within the overall context of land use as described in the IPCC guidelines and in terms of our reporting under the United Nations Framework on Climate Change, the LULUCF regulation uses a slightly adjusted subset but directly related disaggregation to those activities. So under the LULUCF regulation, which is AFOR 1 of 2018, there are 7 accounted for land use disaggregations. These are afforested land, deforested land, managed forest land, managed cropland, managed grassland, managed wetland, and harvested wood products. And harvested wood products is then subsequently subdivided between deforested land and managed forest land. As I briefly outlined, the base period for the LULUCF regulation in terms of the accounting principles is the average emissions and removals in the years 2005 to 2009. And the reason for this base period is because the lack of availability of significant quantities of detailed information on land use activities prior to that. There is 2 compliance periods under the LULUCF regulations, the first being the period 2021 to 2025, the second being 2026 to 2030. And these, in addition to this, there are 2 assessments. The first assessment will be in 2027, which will assess the entirety of the first commitment period. In 2032, there will be an assessment of the second commitment period, and which will be in addition to the previous one. This will then provide the level of flexibility that Ireland will have accrued over the period 2021 to 2030, and be available for use under the effort sharing regulation targets. In terms of how we might likely reach this, forestry in Ireland would not be sufficient alone to meet these targets. So there will be a requirement to monitor or to establish the accounted for reduction in emissions or improvement in sinks in the other land use categories such as grasslands, wetlands and cropland. However, within the regulations, wetlands are only to be managed to be mandatorily reported for the second period 2026 to 2030. However, under the programme for government, a decision will be made at government level as to whether Ireland will include emissions and removals from wetlands in the first period 2021 to 2025. Furthermore, legislation also requires for projection of future emissions and removals, including the effects of land use policies and measures. And additionally, to be able to track and develop systems, work is required to build systems to track land use and land use change and estimate emissions and removals to meet the reporting requirements. In terms of what has been done to address the requirements of the LULUCF regulations and the effort sharing regulation, there's quite a body of national research which has been funded by both the EPA and the Department of Agriculture, Food and Marine. This is largely designed around soil carbon modelling, peatlands research in terms of the properties of our peatlands, but also in terms of the amount of drains and indeed the status of drains on our peatlands. Tragus are currently undertaking a project looking at water table manipulation in terms of our grasslands and organic soils. And indeed, we're also just recently funded a project looking at the biomass content of hedgerows. However, further work is required, and especially and most importantly, around repeated soil carbon measurements. However, research projects alone will not meet the reporting requirements. We also need to look at furthering our knowledge in terms of land cover and land use mapping. And as you may be aware, Ireland now has a national land cover mapping program that is currently ongoing. As an addition to this program, we aim to begin work on developing a spatial land use map, which will use available information in terms of national data sets, but more importantly, it will require significant stakeholder involvement in its development going forward. And just to wrap up, two slides and conclusions. Firstly, Ireland needs to deliver the full flexibility available to it under the effort sharing regulation, and this is clearly outlined in Action 132 of the Climate Action Plan. To meet our longer term climate goals, however, afforestation rates need to increase from their current low levels up to the planned 8,000 hectares. In terms of the LULUCF regulations, detailed analysis is and will be required to demonstrate progress and make full use of the 26.8 million tonnes available to Ireland under the effort sharing regulation. And more importantly, data is king and significant involvement is needed from stakeholders going forward. And just to finish off, maybe to reiterate a comment from Laura at the start, is that appropriate land management is a vital part of action on climate change, and not only in Ireland, but across the EU and globally. Where land management provides to store carbon, for example, forestry, these stores should be maintained or enhanced. Where land management is an emitter of carbon dioxide, these emissions should be reduced or eliminated, an example here being grasslands and organic soils, and where land is degraded and has lost its ability to store carbon, it should be restored, and an example here being peatlands. Thank you.